Hello, malty moldy Manxman, and thank you to Rob G for that malt mention. Welcome to Ralfy Review 684, and welcome to a whiskey review. Excuse me a second, the cork's rather tight. Of the latest version of Lagavulin Distillers Edition. This interesting stuff relating to this whiskey. And yes, you are seeing double, nearly double, virtually double, but not quite double. I have an earlier version here. And I'm going to pour a glass of that as well as the other glass I've just poured. And what I'm going to do is compare them as part of this Ralfy review. Lagavulin is an Islay distillery. It is renowned, famous, notorious for its very phenolic, smoky and peaty, rich dried fruit complex signature as a single malt. And it has built up quite a reputation over the years amongst the discerning single malt drinkers and those who like an awful lot of flavour in their liquor. It doesn't disappoint in that respect. The 16 standard year old Lagavulin, it's had a bit of a mixed press recently because of some poorer batches which have been in circulation, and I think the main trouble that malt mates around the world have is when you're paying the full price for a whisky, but you're simply not getting the full experience compared to your previous bottle, that rankles a little bit. And I would say at this moment in time in 2017 that your distiller's edition version of Lagavulin is probably the more consistent option. Sure, it's a little more, bit more jammy, it's a little sweeter, a little more sherried, a little more kind of rounded, and some of the earthy and mineral complexity of a good edition of the standard 16-year-old tends to be lost. But many of the fans of the 16-year-old have now migrated to the 12-year-old and the 8-year-old. There we go. That's the way you kick off a whisky review. Now, I'll let that sit for a minute. I'm going to add a wee drop of water. I'll tell you a little bit about more about this for your points of reference. It's bottled at 43%, and this specifically is reference numbered IGV.4505, which basically means this particular batch was distilled in the year 2000 and bottled in the year 2016, making it 15 or 16 years old. The other bottle, just as a point of reference, 1 teaspoonful of water in each glass, is the previous edition. This is IGV.4/504. So here we have bottle 504 edition and bottle 505 edition, and I have reviewed this one. You'll find it in Ralfy Review 576, which I recorded in March 2016. And there's a bit of a timeline as regards Lagavulin Distillers Edition, because I've now, after with this review, I've done 4 reviews of the same whiskey but different batches. And so if you look back in the ralfy.com archives, I've got my yellow post-it sticky. There we go. Post-it. There we go. So useful, these sticky stuffs. The problem is that the sticky soon wears off and then it gets mislaid. Better with a traditional notebook and a pencil. So if you go back to the original review, when I was sitting outside in the back garden in the snow in Ralfy Review 99, well, it was Whiskey Review then, that was December in 2009 I recorded that. Then that was the 2008 edition. Then the 2013 edition I recorded in March 2014, Ralphy Review 435. And then this one was the last one I did last year, March 2016. This is the 2015 version in Ralphy Review, Whiskey Review 576. How time flies. What have we got in the nose here? Sweet dried fruit raisins, cherries, little dried dark cherry note, maraschino. A little bit of plum spirit, matured plum spirit. And of course, last but very far from least, a lot of smoke. But the smoke's kind of rounded off with the sweetness of this sherry secondary maturation. The peat is certainly there. Interestingly, when I'm nosing it, the whole experience just seems a little more vague and distant. Not quite as pungent and in your face as previous versions of Lagavulin Distiller's Edition. I can distinctly remember, because these are things you don't forget with smells, the early editions would rush out to meet you. You'd literally sit the glass down in the kitchen sink and you'd still smell it standing at the back door or and even another room in the house, you'd smell it. But this is altogether more restrained. It's still that unmistakable Lagavulin character, which comes primarily from heavily peated malted barley from the Port Ellen maltings on Islay, being put through the fattest stills in Scotland that are Lagavulin. And literally, it's a pot still with that's looks extremely obese. That's a good way of putting it, with a big fat line arm at the top. And this, of course, allows the heavy weighted long molecule congeners of phenols to make their way through in the run without too much reflux. Well, basically with minimal reflux. Taste. Drier than I was expecting when I first opened the bottle. I was expecting the flavour to be more sweet, slightly more sugary and confectionery, but it's not. It's really nicely balanced, civil, I would say politely dry is the arrival in the palate. The peat tends to predominate. There's that general reference to sherry and dried fruit, but it's the peat and the smoke that are still continuing to be the main feature, although, again, I'm noticing it more restrained, more holding itself back. The development, and I have to come back for another sip of this. Dried fruit, consistent smoke and peat throughout, although, funnily enough, the smoke tends to be more prominent, slightly oily, carbolic, ashy, chimney sooty. In a sense, when we think of smoke, we just have a general smoke notion when it comes to smells or reference to smell. But once you've spent a bit of time with Lagavulin, it's like the Scandinavians have a 100 words for snow, or even 1,000 words for snow. You'll get many words and descriptors for the presence of smoke, and it's very much part of the Lagavulin experience. But the development, it's quite young, really, for the age of this whiskey. I get the impression that the initial maturation in the early casks has been fairly slow and undramatic, certainly lacking comprehensive maturation that we generally accept as the traditional influence of maturation. But the plus point of that is that when you've got less overt cask influence, some of the heavier notes coming through the distillate tend to remain intact for longer, and it's certainly the case here. It's opening up more now. There's a bit more extension to the development. A syrupy note, dry syrup, butterscotch, slight mintiness, camphor, turmeric, yes, that kind of dry, slightly bitter spice in the background. Clove, yes. Cinnamon, yes. Allspice, yes. Nutmeg, little hint of nutmeg towards the finish. The finish is really what you call gunpowder tea or Lapsang Souchong, but not, it's like half and half Lapsang Souchong and ordinary breakfast tea. It's not quite as overtly fermented black tea note that I've associated with previous incarnations of the Distiller's Edition Lagavulin. Oh, damn. I'm now tempted to go to this previous glass, which I haven't tasted for a long time. I basically got my neutral gas aerosol private preserve and put a squish in here. Not much, you don't need much to create a gas blanket to stop the whiskey oxygenating and deteriorating. Pleased to say it's really done its job. This is, without doubt, got darker notes to it. It's immediately recognisable as the same whiskey, and it's, in many respects, it's very similar. But this seems a little bit younger, a little bit fresher, a little bit rougher around the edges. And it's not been sort of rounded off by overt syrupy notes coming from the sherry cask. Whereas the older version, it actually has more range of flavour. I'm picking out bitter licorice notes and slight anise notes from the earlier version, which I'm not picking up in the new version. It's a very pleasant, lovely whiskey. Malt marks. I won't bother giving malt marks. Well, will I give malt marks for that? Yes, I will, actually. Why not? I will give this 86 out of 100, and that malt mates is a malt mark. Before I give a malt mark to the previous version, I'm going to taste it again, just to be sure. There's more wood bitters and slight gentian notes in the previous version. It's tasting it now, after about a year, I would give that 88 out of 100 for a malt mark. But what I'm going to do now, just for clarity, I'm going to remove this previous batch away, so as not to cause any malt mark confusion with the latest batch, number 4-505. Right. Lagavulin is a bit like Macallan and Springbank and Highland Park, another good example. It's one of these iconic Scotch single malts, which is highly recognisable globally. And the reason is quite simple. It has such a particular, uncompromising, full phenolic-driven flavour profile, which, for those who don't like it, it's still respected, but those who do like it, these big phenolic blast complex congener stuff. I'm running out of original descriptors, because you can't really kind of overanalyze this in respect of it's smoke, it's peat, it's dried fruit, and if you get a good version, you get some additional accompanying complexity. And in a sense, because it has such dedicated fan base who are willing to pay a significant premium for the more unusual bottlings, the versions of this, like the Fischel bottlings, jazz festival bottlings, those sort of bottlings, which really command quite significantly high prices at auction, people are prepared to pay well over the odds for, you know, older bottlings of Lagavulin, simply because even though the phenols diminish over time, it's still got the name, the cachet. You don't really see it much amongst the independent bottlers. The few that I have tried from independent bottlers, frankly, were not very good, and they were expensive, and they were not worth the money. But you would buy them anyway, because knowing that even independent bottlings at auction are going to command high prices, therefore it's a good little banker for a flip, for the occasional amateur's flip, which is no harm in that, because we're not talking about manipulative professional speculators here. That's a whole different ballgame. But it seems to me that such is the recognition that Lagavulin gets, that if I was opening a distillery, whether it be in Scotland or anywhere else in the world, I would be looking at the high profile single malt whiskies from Scotland and looking to understand what is the flavour that fascinates the fans. That's the crux of it. So really, you just go online, you go to Google Images, and you put in Lagavulin stills, and you actually look at the physical size and shape of these stills. And then you order a carbon copy from Forsyth's in Scotland, and you take it somewhere in the world which is of good provenance and a good location. And then you import some malted, heavily peated malted barley, whether it be 55, 60 or 80 parts per million, and you put it through your still, knowing that as soon as the stuff's matured and getting bottled, that there's going to be a big surge of interest in it. It seems pretty obvious, but you really don't see much evidence of that happening out there. The nearest I've ever seen to this has been McCarthy's Oregon single malt, which I bought and reviewed in the past while it was still available in the UK, and for an a non-age statement, young, really young single malt, it was good. And it was good because it was craft made, it was carefully slowly matured and then slowly distilled and then matured in good quality assertive proactive casks. So the experience was worth the money with McCarthy's. And I reckon there's certain hot spots around the world where a Lagavulin style of liquor could be very successfully made. We can start with Finland, Norway, Iceland, Canada, New Zealand, Tasmania. There we go. You notice that I'm choosing northern and southern latitudes. The further away from the equator you go, I think that the more the heavy phenolic, intense peated whiskies worked. And to a certain extent, you saw that would happen with Amrut, who transported casks of whiskey up to northern Europe to mature them in northern Europe, and then got a different flavour of spirit. There you go. In fact, it was Heligoland. Look it up in Google Maps. Interesting little spot in the world. It's seen a lot of activity, Heligoland, in the recent past. But I'm really just kind of thinking aloud to a certain extent, malt mates. But you can see that we do enjoy, we have got a soft spot for Lagavulin, but increasingly we're disappointed by what we perceive as the dumbing down of the brand. And to a certain extent, it's tempting to blame the distiller, but the distiller can only use the barrels they've got, and they are structured in that they have to make specific returns on investment. And in a sense, they're restricted by these obstacles, whereas a small craft distiller can make the time to take the time to create their own version of Lagavulin. And in doing so, if it works, you can guarantee the sales. And it doesn't matter where in the world that it's made. It just does not matter, maltmates. And I'll tell you why. And this is my concluding statement. It's the global village now. And often globalization is seen as something draconian imposed by the deep state, dark side elite from the top down. And to some extent that's true. But what's fascinating when one is online is to see globalization from the grassroots. Just how much the international community of humanoids around the world are identifying just how much common ground is experienced in life across nationalities that bypasses these historically default national borders in which we tend to be caged to certain, if you know what I mean. But there we go. That's what happens with whiskey. It gets you chatty and philosophical. That's one of the big, big plus points. Marvellous. I'll have one wee taste before I go. Yeah, there's a little slight apple vinegar citrus sour note that's masking things in the development and the finish, and it didn't used to be there. Maybe that's why early versions of Distiller's Edition Lagavulin, when I had the black label, are making such good money at auction these days. There you go. Now you know. I'm Ralphie, and I'm now going to wave bye-bye.